so let's believe that this year at Heart of the Valley is going to be the best year ever, but not only for us as a church, but as for you as an individual and your family, that God is going to bring transformation into your house as we prepare to go through the Transform campaign, the spiritual campaign, starting January 22nd. It is going to be awesome. Today, what I want to do is to just kind of give you some guidelines to kind of cultivate your heart, to kind of prep you a little bit, to prepare you for what God has in store. Because I think it's vital that you need to be prepared as you go into something. We just can't go blindly into something, whatever God does or whatever happens, I don't know. But expect God to do something great. But we need to realize there's some barriers that keep us from receiving everything that God wants us to receive. And so I want to kind of talk about that, get those out of the way so that we don't allow them to hinder us and hold us back, that we might receive the blessings of God in 2017. Amen? Amen. Amen. If someone in the back could just do me a favor and turn off that one floodlight that always blinds me. I didn't know if I should wear my Ray-Bans or just, I might not look good. So we can just turn that off. But there it is. Oh, I feel better. Good. Well, let me ask you. Did you do it?
No.
No? Did you make your New Year's resolution?
No.
You know, we always do. And I don't know why. I mean, we never keep them. But every year we make them. And they last a little longer. And then we don't think we really celebrate. It's like, yeah, I made it a little bit further than last year. You know, still struggling. But you know, we do, and we make New Year's resolution because there's that desire in every single one of us to some degree or another to change something. We just want to change something. We just want to be better. We want to improve in different areas of our life. And we want this year to be better than last year.
Yeah.
You know, little boy went up to his father and said, hey, Dad, what's your New Year's resolution this year? And he said, well, you know what? This year I only have one. And his son says, well, what's that, Dad? He said, well, I'm going to do everything within my power this year to make sure that your mother is happy all year. And so the little boy goes to the mother and says, hey, Mom, what's your New Year's resolution? And she said, well, you know what, son, I only really have one. And I'm going to do everything within my power this year to make sure your father keeps his resolution. You know, look, we all make them. Why do we do it? I think it's just because we want to improve ourselves. It's all about change. That's why Heart of the Valley, as we prepare to go into our spiritual transformation campaign for that 50 days, it's all about change. We want to make things better. And so as we roll into this new year, starting in January 22nd, we're going to kick off our campaign. And hopefully, it's going to change you, your family. Hopefully, it's going to change our church.
Amen.
But that word transform, the definition is to be changed outward form into change in appearance. It also means to change in character or condition. The goal of transformation ultimately is a new you,
yeah.
A new family, a new church. Everyone wants transformation to some degree or another. We all have something that we would love to see transformed in our lives. Something to be made new again. Something to be altered or fixed. And as we as a church go through this campaign, we are asking you to commit to 7 areas throughout this campaign so that God can bring about a change in your life. The first one, spiritual. We're going to see a transformation in all of our lives in the spirit. We also, physically, that God's going to do a work in us physically, that we'd be good stewards of our body, the temple of God. Mentally, emotionally, relationally. We all have some relationships we'd like to see a transformation take place in to be better. Financially, that God would teach us how to be good stewards of the finances. And then vocationally. You know what? God can bring a transformation in your heart, in your workplace, as you realize that it's not just a place to make an income, but to make a difference.
Right.
And to realize you're in a harvest field where God can use you to do great things. We here every Sunday night in the small groups and to read your daily devotion. When you get this book, there's a day one, day two, every day for 50 days, just a page. It's just one page that you'll read. Scripture in there, a couple of questions. You can just reflect on what you just read. It's a devotion every day for you to read it. At my house, in the evenings, we'll sit down and we'll read that devotion and we'll pray. It's a great book. It's like three books in one. You also have the small group book that's in this. And then also there's the portion here for the Sunday morning services. So this book, $15, leather bound, it's got a nice page marker. It's a great book and something that you'll keep for years and years and to reflect on and to go back to. And so make sure on your way out that you sign up and get one. We'll be ordering them this week. But we want to make sure that everyone has one. Why is it important that we commit to these things I just mentioned? Because all of us become whatever we're committed to. Whatever you commit your life to, your time, your energy, you're going to become that. And if we would take these 50 days to commit to transformation in those seven areas, we're going to see tremendous blessing upon our lives. And it's vital that we do that. And what is the ultimate goal? That we would come out on the other side of this campaign and each and every one of us would look a little bit more like Jesus. That's it. That we would look a little bit more like Jesus. You know, on the wall near the main entrance of the Alamo in San Antonio, Texas, there's this portrait. And under the portrait, there's this inscription. And it reads, James Butler Bonham, no picture of him exists. This portrait of his nephew, Major James Bonham, deceased, who greatly resembled his uncle. It is placed here by the family that the people may know the appearance of the man who died for freedom. Think about that. You know, there's no physical portrait of Jesus. But for those of us who follow Christ, hopefully the world will see a resemblance of Jesus in us. That we become a portrait. That the world will see the image of the one who laid down his life for freedom. That we'll be set free from the bonds of sin. And that we can be free to walk in the Spirit of Christ and ultimately enjoy salvation. That is the goal of this campaign. Is that we would look more like Jesus. So that the world around you will see the image of Christ, the one who died for him. And that they would realize, as the scripture says, that they were with them and they knew that they had been with Jesus. When you are around your coworkers and neighbors and friends and family members, do they feel, wow, this person's been with God? They know Jesus. That's the goal. We all, basically, this new year, 2017, is going to be the year of transformation as you grow in your faith, as your family grows in your faith, and there's this new grounding in our faith that makes us stable and strong, not only you as an individual, but us as a church, that we would be a reflection of Christ to the world and to this community, that lives would be touched and changed. So in 2017, how can we be transformed? I wanted to share a few things because there's some barriers that are going to hinder you from growing in the Lord. There's going to be barriers that are going to try to block you, to hold you back, to keep you from becoming everything God wants you to be. And I want us to look at those things today. They're invisible walls, invisible fences, whatever you want to call it. They're not physical structures that literally cannot or hold you back. They're these invisible barriers or fences that are going to hold you back if you allow them to. It's like, have you ever heard of the product Invisible Fence? And you use it to train your dogs. And so they put these in your yard, right on the border of your property. And when the dog gets near it, it sets off an alarm that's inaudible for us. We can't hear it, but it's this high-pitched sound that the dogs can't stand. It just irritates them. And then, at the same time, you're training them. When the dogs go in there, and all of a sudden they hear this high-pitched sound that's really annoying them, and then you're saying, get back. And you're working on your training them. It's not just the sound, but it's also the training that goes involved in it. And so this invisible fence, ultimately, when it works through the process, the dog learns to never go beyond that. Now, obviously, there's nothing physical, nothing there to really hinder the dog who wants to cross and take off. It can do that. But think about that, that's what the enemy tries to do in our lives, and as well as God. But the thing is, I want us to think about is that there's two fences, invisible fences, that I want you to bust through. And then there's one that I want you to yield to and not go past and to learn from. On your outline, write this down. Transformation happens when we are mindful of the invisible walls in the spirit realm. Transformation happens when we are mindful of the invisible walls in the spirit realm. Satan tries to build walls in your life to create a resistance so that you resist the things of God and pull back. And mainly, all he uses is smoke and mirrors and intimidation. Satan has no power over you. So he has to kind of manipulate you and trick you and to do things that will hinder you and to slow you down. God builds invisible wall in your life as well to keep you out of the devil's playground. So that one is the one we need to yield to. The other ones we need to bust through. But so often we yield to this invisible wall that the enemy sets up, and I'm going to explain that to you in a minute. You can't experience transformation until you push through the devil's invisible walls and yield to God's invisible wall. So what are these? I want to look at these. If you have your outline, pull that out. Two invisible walls you need to break through. Number one, the first wall is a reinforced lie written on our hearts. This first invisible wall that the enemy likes to set up is a reinforced lie he has written on your heart that we fall and we yield to so often. Let me give you an example. Remember when Moses and the Israelites were wandering around in the desert? Well, basically the time was like, hey, go receive the promised land. And so Moses sends some spies in. He says, hey, go check it out, scout it out, let us know what we're in for, and come back, give us a report, and we're going in. And so they go, and they're checking it all out, and they evaluate everything. They come back, right? They're excited. This is the promised land. Now, here's what's funny about this. If it's promised by God, it's going to happen, right? And so that should give you confidence enough as it is. But look what happened to them when they came back. They got with Moses, and look what it says here in Numbers 13:27. This was their report to Moses. We entered the land you sent us to explore, and it is indeed a bountiful country, a land flowing with milk and honey. Here is the kind of food it produces. But, there's always a but. Now here comes this invisible fence, right? The people living there are powerful, and their towns are large and fortified. Jericho and others. We even saw giants there. Now think about this. They went in, and we often do this. They saw this bountiful country flowing with milk and honey, all the positive, all the wonderful things. Wow, this is the promised land. Then they saw the negatives. How many agree the negatives so often influence us more than the positives? And all of a sudden they come back and said, yeah, it is everything you said, Moses. Wow, it is awesome. But no way. No way are we going to go in there. There's giants in there. There's fortified cities. They're more powerful than we are. And so they give them this whole list of reasons why they should not go in. There was no physical structure there keeping them out from entering in, except the lies that were written on their heart. Satan made such an impression on their heart. It was like branding this in their hearts, and they couldn't shake it. And they came back and they said, there's no way. And the enemy does that. He wants to fill your heart with lies. And those lies become a barrier, an invisible wall that keeps you from trusting God and stepping out and doing great exploits for the kingdom of God. Now, not all of them were influenced. Look at verse 30-32. But Jacob tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Let us go at once and take the land, he said. We can certainly conquer it. But the other men who had explored the land with them disagreed. We can't. That word can't should not even be in our vocabulary as believers. We can't go up against them. They are stronger than we are. So they spread the word. They spread this bad report about the land among the Israelites. And the land we traveled through and explored will devour anyone who goes to live there. Think about this. This is what Satan does. Just starts with just a few. Israelites. There's over a million of them sitting in the wilderness. A million, over a million, ready to, let's go in. And you have a handful of people say, no, we can't do that. No, we were there. It's ugly. They're more powerful than us. They're fortified. They're more stronger. We're going to be devoured if we go in there. Are you kidding me? Don't listen to Caleb. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And they, the word there, spread. They went, hey, no, we don't want to go in there. Don't, no, we don't want to go in there. Until the entire nation was convinced, yeah, even though God promised it, but the giants, there's these big fortified cities, they're more powerful than us. And they decided to not pursue the will of God. That was a decision. Satan built this wall, this invisible wall of lies. Church, what are the lies that the enemy has written on your heart that is holding you back from receiving from God? That is keeping you from doing great things for the kingdom of God? You know? You know how things change as you pass it, something along. And we're talking a million people. You know, some of them are like, yeah, we can't go in there. Why? I don't know. They said something about walls. Really? I don't know. They said something about giants. I don't know. What is that all about? I don't know. I heard that too. Yeah, I heard that. I don't know. They don't even know why they're not going in there. I mean, they're confused, but they just know they shouldn't go in there. And they were conditioned to believe this lie that they were unable. They were a million strong, but they were convinced this invisible wall that really isn't a wall at all. Convince them to stay behind. Satan uses that and creates these invisible walls. And he's going to do it as we draw near to this campaign. He's going to write these lies in your heart saying, you know what, you don't have time for this. You're busy. You can't be doing that. You're not going to be that devotion every day. Are you kidding me? Don't commit to that kind of stuff. And he's going to give you every reason in the world to say, yeah, I really can. You know, think about this. I think about, this is like the zoo that did an experiment with apes. They had this big pen cage, had five apes in it. And so they took a rope and they tied this cluster of bananas and they hung it in the cage. And so when one of the apes would go to approach these bananas, they had these water cannons set up and they just blasted the ape and the other four as well, all of them, just blasting them. And then they turn it off, and after a while, they think, okay, I'm going to get that banana. And so they would approach the banana again, and the water would come on and just blast them. They continued to do this till it got to the point where the apes were no longer going to try to get the banana. So the banana would hang there, and they would never even bother, right? So then they decide, you know, let's take an ape out and put it in a new one with the other four. And so now there's five apes, so one of them's new and the other four. They decide to put this banana down, right? Well, the new ape's like, I'm going to get me a banana. So he's heading to get the banana, and the other four apes pounce on him and start beating him up. And he's like, well, I just want a banana. No, you can't have a banana. Okay. So then they take another one out, and then they put a second ape in. Now, they put these bananas out, right? Well, the new ape doesn't know. He's going for the banana, right? So the four jump on him. The three original ones are just beating on this guy. The first two guys beating on him. He doesn't even know why he's beating on him. He just knows that you're not supposed to get the banana. And so they continue this. They put a third egg and a fourth egg, right? And they got all these in there. And so then they take the last original, fifth egg out, put a new one in, right? Put the banana. The new guy's going after the banana. Now you have four apes jumping on this egg, pouncing on him, and they have no idea why they're doing it. And you got to the point where they eventually have five apes in there, and none of them are going to go after the banana, and they have no idea why. And I think that's what the enemy does. He'll condition us. You can't do that. And you have a million Israelites who are like, yeah, we can't get the banana. You kidding? They're bigger than us. They'll devour us. And he'll send this lie that we buy into. And he conditions us and gives us all these reasons why. And we're like, yeah, I'm not going to do that. And God's like, are you kidding me? I promised it to you. Trust in my promises. You know, the Bible is filled with promises that we don't stand on. And we're just like that. And we allow the enemy to just experiencing God's promises and blessings in your life. I'm never going to change. I'm always going to have this habit, this hang-up, this hurt. I'm always going to struggle. I'm always going to make a mistake. I'm never going to grow in my faith. I'm never. I can't. Even though there's literally no physical wall keeping you from trusting God and stepping out and receiving God's blessing, except the lies that you've allowed the enemy to write on your heart. The second invisible fence, the second wall, is Satan's line in the sand. There's those things that the enemy will let you get away with, and you can trust God for that, but then there's those times he's going to draw a line in the sand and say, you know what, you're not going to go there. You're not going to do this. And we allow him to manipulate us. And look what it says in Judges chapter 1, verse 19. So the Lord was with Judah. Now, that piece of truth right there, you just need to understand as we read this. God was with them. Okay? That's all you need. Because the Bible says, if God is with you, who can be against you? Right? Okay. So the Lord was with Judah. And they drove out the mountaineers. But they could not drive out the inhabitants of the lowland because they had chariots of iron. Now, this is interesting. Other translations say, you know, they were able to conquer the men on the mountaintop or the high places, but when they went down into the valley, they were unable to beat them because they had chariots of iron. Now, the irony of this, think about this. Here they are. God can win this battle, but then it's like Satan draws a line and says, yeah, but you're not going to take this one. Has nothing to do with it. I mean, God said, no, I'm going to give you victory no matter what. But the enemy so often challenges us, and I'm going to give you a little piece of truth that will carry you through life in just a moment. But that line in the sand, it's really that thing that, well, I can believe God for this, but this is the area I cannot believe and trust God for. It reminds me of Peter when he walked on the water. Now think about this, because here he's walking on the water, things are going good, he sees the waves and wind, he becomes fearful and falls, right? Let me ask you a question. Is it more difficult to walk on water when the sun's shining or when it's windy? The weather's irrelevant. The same is true because it's the miracle of God that enabled him to walk on the water. Same is true in this situation. The chariots of iron are irrelevant. But for some reason, they could trust God for the men, the fighting on the ground, but those, the horsemen and those on the chariots, there's no way we can take them. And that should be all irrelevant, because really, God's the one that fights the battles, amen? God's the one that gives us the victory. Now, the problem is this demonic fence, this wall, says we can cross only at designated areas. And here's what Satan does. Here's what I want you to think about. Because you've got to remember, here we have these Israelites and that have just gone through all these incredible victories. Number one, God destroying Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea. And then there's a million thirsty Israelites at one point, and he satisfied all of them by pouring water out of a rock. And then they get into these other battles, and we can't take the promised land. Forget about that. And this is the key. We lose sight of the fact that God with us. And Judges 1 here that we just read. So the Lord was with Judah. Now think about this. Now I want you, does this make sense to you? Because the Lord was with Judah. So the Lord was with Judah, and they had victory in the lowlands or in the high places, in the mountaintops, right? The Lord was with Judah, and they were unable to beat them because they have chariots of iron. Here's what Satan does. He knows that there is no problem that he can create that is bigger than God. He knows that he can't come to you and say, you know what, that situation is bigger than your God. Just surrender. So he doesn't even play that game. What he does is he'll let you win a couple battles here and there, and then you get over to this situation, and he creates a problem in your life. An issue, a battle in your life, whatever it might be, that is not bigger than your God, but one that is bigger than you. so we want to grow in our faith. Satan knows that he's defeated. The problem is sometimes we don't know that. We don't remember that. And we allow him to create this problem. Look, I don't know about you, but when I look into the Bible, it says that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The Bible, it says that with God, all things are possible. God is saying, you know, who can be against you? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And Mark says that God can do anything. And so that's what we need to lean on and trust in as we prepare ourselves to go through this transformation. Because I guarantee you, as we go and lean in and start approaching this campaign, God already knows exactly what he wants to do in your life. God's already excited. He's like, man, I can't wait for them to go through because I see what I'm going to do to them in week one and week three and week six, and I'm going to bless their family, and I'm going to increase their faith, and I'm going to give them victory in this area and that area. But all along, though, the enemy's trying to put up his fence, saying, you know, he wants to write these lies on your heart, saying, no, God's not going to do that. You don't have time for that. He's going to draw a line in the sand. You know, you can trust God for the little things over here, but not these things. Look, we're going to believe through this campaign, transform, that God is going to destroy those invisible fences that the enemy has put up in our lives. Because that's the only way he can do it, is through manipulation, smoke and mirrors. Because we have the victory. And that is what God wants to do. So, with that being said, as we prepare for this campaign, we need to realize that the enemy is going to try to put up those barriers to hinder your growth, to hinder your commitment, your involvement. Commit and let God begin to start something new. So push through those walls. Now the one wall you need to yield to is the third one. That's God's wall. God's invisible wall that he sets up. That's the word of God written on our hearts. The word of God and the spirit of God. Because look, it works the same way. Back to the invisible fence with the dog training thing. It's like that. We'll go about our business, and we come upon this boundary, this line, where we're about to cross that into an area we know it's not pleasing to the Lord. It's not something God would want us to do. And all of a sudden, that alarm goes off, the conviction of the Holy Spirit, and then we need to lean on the instruction and training from his word. But so often, we blow through that. And God is like, no, I want you to be more sensitive to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. So when you get to the edge, when that alarm's going off, and I'm trying to say, hey, don't go there, don't do that, and I'm enabling you to recall the training of my word, thou shalt not, and do this, and love one another, and on and on and on. And the word of God that has instructed us, and the conviction of the Holy Spirit that is alarming us, that's God's invisible fence, just like the one that you use to train dogs. It works like that if we're sensitive and we allow God to do that. And it keeps us on his path. Look what it says here in Psalm 32, verse 8 through 9. The Lord says, I will guide you. That's the working of the Holy Spirit. I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you. That's God's word, the counsel. And watch over you. Do not be like the senseless horse or mule that needs a bit or bridle to keep it under control. This is exactly what's happening in the Garden of Eden. God instructed. He talked. He walked with Adam and Eve. And he said, look, see that tree over there? Don't eat of it. Anything else you can have. Cool. And then one day, the enemy, like he does, he tries to pull you across the line. He says, really? You can't eat that? You can eat everything else but that one? Are you sure about that? Yes. God said, if I eat of that, I will surely die. And Satan totally counters that and says, really, you're not surely going to die. Here's what's going to happen if you do, though. You're going to be like God. You're going to know the difference between right and wrong. You're going to be like God, and we all want to be God. We all want to be in control of our lives. We want to be like God, and that apple looked good. And the devil the whole time is trying to push you. Go, you can do it. Yeah, it's okay. It's all right. You're not going to die. bondage is one who voluntarily accepts that bondage. Why? Because we have picture. Look, a pastor one day was flying back from a speaking engagement. They're landing in the airport that was surrounded by water. And he noticed, as he's looking out the window, this little tugboat that was pulling this massive naval ship. This naval vessel was being pulled by this little tugboat. And he was just watching, just cruise real slow. And he just thought to himself, he goes, I wonder what happened if that big old ship fired up those big motors, put it in reverse, and just pulled that tugboat all over the place. And it was kind of a comical scene. But the Spirit of God quickened him right there and said, you know what? The only reason why that tugboat is pulling that massive ship is because that massive ship is yielding to it and is allowing it to. And so often, that is our situation. The only reason why the devil slaps us around and drags us around is because we allow him to. We don't have to. We can just fire up those engines of the Holy Spirit and who's greater, that lives within me, and the issues and the struggles and the problems of this world, and stand up against it and take victory, take hold of it. Look what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. So either this is a lie, and I don't think God's word ever tells a lie, and you agree with that? So we realize, yes, we are tempted. But it's saying here, he will not let you. God is not going to let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. So we can bear it. We just make an excuse. I just can't control myself. It's just too big. It's too hard. We need to lean on God. Trust God. I know sometimes it is difficult. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. Do you see what God knows how difficult it is. And he's going to help you. He's going to make a way of escape if you trust him. In Romans 6, verse 16, look what it says here. Don't you know that whenever you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey. Whether you are a slave to sin, which leads you to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. I think the key in this scripture, what's underlying, when you yield, and it's on you. The issue really in this scripture isn't about the control of the spirit of the flesh or sin or righteousness. The issue is you yielding to one of them. You're in control. And so we need to understand that. If you are struggling with something as a Christian, the only thing holding you is that invisible fence. Push through that. You know, Paul, look what Paul said. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Proverbs 16:32. Better to be patient than powerful. Better to have self-control than to conquer a city. See, we've got to learn that those things are going to come our way. But we need to be sensitive to God, the Spirit of God, that we would hear the siren go off of the Holy Spirit saying and convicting, that ping of the Holy Spirit saying, don't go there. And recalling and leaning on the instruction and the counsel of God's word that tells us right from wrong and how we should live our lives. We need to be more sensitive to that. That's the wall you yield to. When you get to that point of temptation, you need, say, God, give me strength here. I hear the siren. I sense your conviction. I know what your word says. Let me be obedient to help me. Give me victory. Give me a way out. Show me. Give me strength. We have to cry out sometimes and yield. Then those invisible walls that the enemy sets up, those are the ones you push through. I'm not going to listen to lies. Satan, you're no longer going to write lies in my heart that I'm going to fall. No longer am I going to yield to the line in the sand. I'm going to push through. And I'm going to walk in a way that brings glory and honor to the kingdom of God. And different churches, we go through this campaign. If the worship team would go ahead and make the way up here. Let me say this. Well, as we prepare, I felt in my spirit that God wanted me to just address some things that are going to hinder you. The flesh is going to hinder you. That you're not going to receive the most from the campaign. It's like, yeah, I'll hit this. I might come a couple Sundays. I might do a couple devotions. I might show up on a couple Sunday nights. That's right where the enemy wants you. He's going to do everything he can to limit the change. And we know in our heart of hearts, we all want change. That's why we do resolutions. And we know that I'm going to stop doing this. I'm going to start doing this. And it's, and the same is true. So this year, 2017, we want it to be different. We want to see the transformation of your life, your family, our church, to become everything that God desires us to be. That we truly experience God in a whole new way, in a fresh way, as we yield to Him and allow Him to speak into our life in a new way. Because sometimes as Christians, we've heard it so much and gone to church so much that you start going through the motions and the change stops. And then it just becomes religion. And God wants to continue to change. And so we are asking that you prayerfully consider saying, Lord, you know what? To the best of my ability, I want to go through this campaign and receive your transformation for my life, whatever that might be. I have no expectations, Lord, except the fact that I know you're going to do something, and I just want what you want to do to happen. Bless my family, and Lord, may we bring glory and honor to you. You see, as we prepare to take communion, Jesus died at Calvary to give us all life eternal. But more than that, to make us more than conquerors today. To give you victory today. Don't listen to the lie like, you know what, you're just going to have to live with your issues until you die. And one day you meet heaven and everything will be wonderful. That's not God's plan for your life. He wants you to walk in the joy of the Lord, which is your strength. He wants you to walk in the peace of God. He wants you to trust Him and receive His promises.